Are you afraid to cook without a recipe, but are you eager to start trusting your gut more when it comes to cooking? Are you trying to shop more local and in season, but find it hard to find recipes to match the foods available in your area? Or are you looking into intuitive eating and would you like to bring this concept into the kitchen with you? So in today's video, I am super excited to be sharing my 7 steps to intuitive cooking success. Hi guys, my name is Dee Dee and I'm an Irish-based registered dietitian working for my dietetic consultancy, Dee Dee-tician. I work both clinically in hospital and I provide one-to-one and group workshops to help make evidence-based nutrition information a little bit more accessible and fun. I also write about a wide variety of nutrition and health-related topics on my blog, DeeDee-tician.com, and I produce a new video here every 2 weeks. I'll be producing a blog post on this topic as well, so you can find the link for that in the description box below when it comes out. So I first started my Instagram profile maybe around October 2019, and I was happily sharing photos of my yummy lunches and dinner as food inspo for everyone. But when some of you started asking me for recipes to my meals, I was a little stuck. And I suddenly started realizing that actually I hadn't followed a step-by-step recipe for my own cooking since I left secondary school. My cooking process was intuitive. I followed my own rules and my meals never really resulted in the same meal twice. And so how could I share a recipe when every meal I created was its own glorious creation with infinite potential for tweaks and ingredient swaps? And how do you name a dish with no conventional recipe? So the simple act of trying to capture my photographed meals in a recipe format for you guys made me actually see my years of experience in creating delicious home-cooked meals in a fresh light. Now it made sense why I could never clearly describe what was for dinner in a 1 or 2 word answer. I realized that my recipes had no name. And when I did try to name them, it was usually a long-winded name listing off some ingredients, the general style of the dish, maybe the country or continent that inspired my use of flavors. So for example, I had my French style cod stew with sauteed potatoes and olives, or what else did I have? My Asian style tofu and ginger vegetable stir fry. You know, it's a long, long name. And I think really in the process that I'm doing right now, I think putting the name intuitive cooking to this style of meal prep really helped me identify what it was that I was actually doing. I was using my intuition to create my own delicious masterpieces. So what is intuitive cooking? Well, intuitive cooking is using and trusting your intuition when cooking rather than following a recipe step by step. It is making the most of the availability of fresh ingredients and enhancing the flavors by using your own preferred cooking methods and flavorings. And why are we afraid to share our intuitively cooked meals? Because I think a lot of us are cooking this way. Well, I attempted to share some of my recipes on Instagram with a clear and almost apologetic disclaimer that my cooking methods were intuitive and not based on a true cuisine or cooking style. My ingredients lists were rough estimates, a dollop of this, a spoonful of that. My methods were a little unconventional, dump everything in a pot and hope for the best. But your feedback has been phenomenal. So many of you guys recognized yourself in my honesty, and some of you shared that you often did not even post your more intuitive meals on social media as you felt they didn't fit into a conventional template. With so many of us looking to recipes in our cooking, it can feel as if cooking is only a process, right, to get to the end goal. A meal that represents the name of the recipe that we followed. Experts put up a new recipe and you only succeed in completing the recipe if your dish looks and tastes like the expert's dish. We follow distinguished steps to make a lasagna. We want a teriyaki tofu stir fry to look like the picture in our recipe book. And so an intuitively cooked meal that does not look or taste like a conventional dish may not fit into the normal template of a meal that we see being shared online or discussed in magazines. And perhaps this is why we feel that our intuitive dishes do not deserve to be shared openly. So how common is intuitive cooking? To be honest, I believe that we all use elements of intuition in our cooking, even when we do follow a recipe. Don't we intuitively look at the top of the cake when we're baking to see if it might be ready to come out of the oven? We know what to expect in the texture of the potatoes when we are checking to see if they are cooked right. We would leave them in longer than the recipe says if they're not cooked. The more experience you have in cooking, of course, the easier this type of intuition will come to you. But no matter how experienced you are in cooking, I know that deep down, you will all know if you like or dislike the smell, taste, or look of the food as you are preparing it. Does it need more salt? Should I leave out the broccoli from the recipe because I just don't like broccoli? Should I cook the pie a little longer to get that extra brown crust I like? And perhaps cooking is one of our oldest intuitions. Using food that's available to us, cooking it in a way that makes it easier for us to digest, and flavoring it with ingredients that will make it taste better. Guys, we've been doing this stuff for absolute millennia, so trust your gut a little bit. It's in your genes. So is there a link between intuitive cooking and intuitive eating? In short, intuitive eating is a hugely popular and growing philosophy around eating, where you focus on trusting your body to tell you what and when to eat. If you would like to hear more about intuitive eating, let me know in the comment section below, and I can start making videos for you guys on that topic sometime soon. So much like intuitive eating, I feel that intuitive cooking is a great step towards trusting our bodies to tell us what it needs. Does the meal need more or less salt? Sure, taste it and make the call there and then. Do you want your pasta dish to be more filling? Well, perhaps add beans and lentils for a great boost of fiber. Does the recipe call for some difficult to find ingredient? Well, I would say experiment by using more locally sourced and in-season veg that you feel might work instead. You are the master of your dish. Trust your gut, listen to your instincts, and suddenly cooking becomes a lot less daunting and a lot more creative. So what are the benefits of intuitive cooking? To be honest, there's little to no research or even anecdotal information available online on formally, you know, recognized benefits of intuitive cooking. However, some potential benefits of moving away from using recipes and learning to trust your intuition a little bit more in the kitchen may include, first of all, less food waste. Using up some of those foods that are already in the cupboard or fridge in your intuitive recipe, rather than those described in a formal recipe, means that you can cut the all-important food waste. You can even use the leftovers from your recipe the night before in your current recipe, cutting food waste even further. Food waste has a huge environmental impact, not just from the physical decomposing of the food in our landfills, which creates a lot of greenhouse gases, but also by wasting all the resources that were needed to produce the food in the first place. So get your intuitive thinking caps on and make up a recipe which includes those peppers at the back of the fridge. Now, another benefit to intuitive cooking that I found is that it is more sustainable. I love basing recipes on foods which are locally sourced and in season, because not only are they more environmentally sustainable because of the reduced transport and production costs, but also because they taste so much better when they're fresh. So go to your local farmer's market or browse the veg aisle in your local supermarket and keep a little eye out on maybe some of the local veg. Look at where your veg is coming from. Now allow yourself to be inspired by the delicious fresh veg that you come across. Cook them in ways that you can imagine will bring out their flavors best. Now be inspired by the seasons, the weather, the dishes you have tasted in the past, and cut food transport costs while you're at it. Another benefit that I found to intuitive cooking would be that it is simply more fun. Getting intuitive with your cooking means that you give yourself the freedom to have fun. You're not striving for perfection, but instead you're looking to create a meal that you like the taste of. And your taste buds may surprise you. I like using the sniff test to see if a funky spice or herb matches my bubbling sauce or dish that I'm cooking. I'm going to explain that a little bit more later. Allowing myself the freedom to be creative in my cooking has made my time in the kitchen far more interesting and fun. And then another benefit to intuitive cooking that I found is that I find it more satisfying. Intuitive cooking makes it easier to cater for specific diets, for example. And I am pescatarian and I have IBS, so I found that many of the conventional recipes simply didn't match up with my dietary needs. Simply cutting out the ingredients that I try to avoid could easily leave a dish feeling a little bare and not as satisfying. But using my intuition to adapt these recipes allows me to replace a meat-based protein, for example, for a veggie alternative. And it's given me the confidence to replace flavorings and ingredients that I know will trigger my IBS with less volatile ones. And hence my adapted intuitive recipes are far more satisfying and nutritious. So how do I cook intuitively? Honestly, there isn't a one way to cook with your intuition. Whatever floats your boat and soothes your soul will work for this one. But as so many of you were interested in my recipes and my own personalized style of making dishes, I thought I would let you guys in on my intuitive cooking process. First of all, let's look at the prep work, because being a little bit prepared does help me in my intuitive cooking journey. I always try to stock some cupboard essentials that will help me flavor or complement my meals. Of course, these can be completely different for everyone, but here is my cupboard essentials list for making savory meals. Pepper, cans of chopped tomatoes, vinegar, rapeseed oil, olive oil, sesame oil, lemon, onion, garlic, soy sauce, rice, pasta, beans, lentils, bulgur wheat, maybe some quinoa. I like using sweet chili sauce. I always have a bit of maple syrup and stock cubes as well, and coconut milk. And looking at more of the specific kind of herbs and spices, I always seem to have some basil, oregano, thyme, rosemary, maybe some ginger, turmeric, cumin, chili, smoked paprika, and curry powder. Of course, stock whatever you like, go for fresh or go for dried or even go for frozen herbs, whatever you prefer. And here we go. Here is my step-by-step guide on how to cook intuitively. Step one, gather your star ingredients. And for me, these are always veg. I try to shop in season and local, and I love trying something new. So if I pick up one particular star veg, say it's the simple broccoli, I do try to stock up on some of the old time favorites as well to accompany it. So for example, I may pick up some carrots, some peppers and tomatoes to go with my star veg. So step two, decide on a general style of your dish. So here I mean decide if you're feeling up for a soup, maybe a salad or a stew, perhaps look at pasta dishes or a rice and sauce dish. And maybe look for a stir fry or a roast. The list is endless. As you may have guessed, I am not that much of a fan of the general meat, veg, potato dish. However, this is definitely an easier version. Now, be aware guys, tougher and harder veg do need longer cooking or they need finer chopping. So this would include things like your carrots, parsnips, pumpkins, and so forth. So if any of these feature on my veggie stars list, I tend to go for a soup, a stew, or a saucy dish. Now, step three is choose a flavor style. This is where I usually add my country or continent inspiration label. For example, my French style cod. But a little disclaimer, in no true way do I fully stick to true, authentic flavor profiles of a country or cuisine. I'm merely inspired by the flavors of these countries. As I cook intuitively, I tend to add in or take ingredients from each of these profiles. Now, I was asked to share some of the common flavorings that I would use in each of these profiles. Again, before I start, just letting you know that I tend to cook without onion and garlic, for example, because these flare up my IBS symptoms. Honestly, onion and garlic fit so nicely into any savory meal profile, so go for it if you like. I tend to use the green parts of spring onion and maybe some garlic oil to supplement these flavors. I also tend to use maple syrup to sweeten my meals rather than honey. Again, for IBS reasons, but please chop and change any of these ingredients as you like. And lastly, again, before we dive in, I use very little salt in my cooking, but add salt to flavor as you wish. So let's have a little look at some of those flavor profiles. When I'm cooking Asian style dishes, I like using some of the following, and they include ginger, sesame oil, soy sauce, lemon, maybe some sesame seeds, maple syrup, and sweet chili sauce. Now quantities can vary a lot, experiment with some, or all of these flavors to find your perfect balance of sweet, salty, gingery goodness. My Italian style dishes often contain the following flavors. Maybe some chopped up tomato, basil, fresh or dried, oregano, thyme and rosemary, maybe some pepper and some maple syrup again. I also love adding in the salty hints of things like olives, capers or Parmesan cheese. Next, my French style dishes often feature the following ingredients. Maybe some chopped tomato again, stock cubes, thyme, rosemary, parsley, pepper, tarragon, and occasionally even some nutmeg. My South American dishes are mostly inspired by my time in Peru, and so they do include a lot of the following: lemon, coriander, always fresh, onions, and fresh tomato. However, I also have my go-to chili sin carne mix, and that consists of chopped tomatoes, a stock cube, paprika, smoked paprika, chili, and cumin. And lastly, I have an Iberian style flavor, a kind of combination. It's a mix of both Portuguese and Spanish dishes and include chopped tomatoes, paprika, pepper, vinegar, cloves, nutmeg, and even sometimes a little cinnamon. Again, guys, keep in mind that these flavor profiles are only there to guide you. Please use them as rough guides and add or take from them as you wish. I in no way intend to cramp your style. And next is step four, choose a protein source to suit the cooking style. Now, of course, I prefer veggie or fish-based meals. However, you can, of course, choose meat if you wish. Most of my veggie dishes contain beans and lentils. And then occasionally, I also add some form of a veggie alternative protein, maybe something like corn, cheese, eggs, tofu, or tempeh. I especially enjoy tofu and tempeh in my Asian style meals, where I'll marinate them in a mix of all the Asian style flavors that I described earlier. And step five, choose your carb. Now, I'm a sucker for whole grain rice, as it's just so filling and really versatile, because I find it works for most of my South American, Asian, and Iberian meals. I prefer using pasta or bread for my Italian dishes, and maybe some potatoes for my French dishes, but again, just a rough guide. And you can also get a little creative with your carbs. Sometimes I cook something like buckwheat or quinoa into my stews or my soups to thicken them. And this instantly transforms it into one of those one pot meals full of whole grains, which can help increase the variety in your dishes. And last is step six, taste, sniff, and test. Because I think step six is one of the most important steps of this intuitive cooking game. As you and your taste buds are the focus of attention here, you have all the freedom in the world to add any flavors that you feel are missing. Now, if you're feeling a little creative, try the sniff test to see if your curious mind can piece together even more unusual flavor combos. So here we go, this is the sniff test. First of all, taste the dish while it's still cooking. Now, waft some of the steam coming from your dish towards your nose and have a good smell at all the different things going on in there. Now, next, I try to have the open pot of herbs or spices that I'm hoping to add in my hand. And while smelling the vapors coming from the dish, I then hold the jar of the new flavor at my nose. And if it smells like it suits the dish, then great, give it a go and add a little bit. Now, you will know pretty quickly if it doesn't suit, so then just give it a miss. And this is how I suddenly started, for example, adding that hint of cinnamon into my Spanish dishes. It just smelled right, and as expected from my sniff test, it actually somehow tasted right too. So the six steps of my intuitive cooking process are: gather your star ingredients, the veg, decide on a general style of your dish. Next, choose a flavor style, and I gave you a few of my flavor profiles to try. Then choose a protein source to suit your cooking style and choose the carb. And the last step, taste, sniff, and test. Guys, I hope you enjoyed this glimpse into my intuitive cooking process. I would love to hear more about your own intuitive cooking styles, adventures, and flavors. And please, please, please share a photo of your intuitively cooked dishes with me. Guys, let's celebrate the unconventional cooking. Let's celebrate the also common mishmash dishes. And let's start cooking more meals that suit our taste buds rather than those of a star chef or an Instagram recipe creator. If you guys like this video, please let me know down there with a little thumbs up or a little heart and a positive comment below. And for more videos like this one, subscribe to my channel and click that little bell button on my channel page to get notified when the next video comes out. Thanks so much for watching, guys, and I'll see you again in 2 weeks' time. Bye.